So thinking and intelligence we're moving into now. Not unrelated to memory. You have to be able to remember things to think about them. Process of solving problems and making judgments and decisions. Most people don't think about thinking as problem solving, but it is one way to think about it. You're hungry? That's a problem. You solve it pretty quickly, almost automatically, so you don't really think that you're thinking your way through it. But as soon as you ask somebody else where they'd like to go for lunch, and they say one place and you'd rather not go there, now you're thinking how you're going to get them to go to the place you want them to go. And so if you look at life, I got an itch. Do I scratch it? That's a problem. It's pretty easy to solve it. But then we have much bigger problems that we don't really think about as problems, like what am I going to do in life? What do I think about this or that aspect of the political spectrum, for example, this issue or that issue? Should I talk to this person? Shouldn't I talk to this person? I wonder what they think about me at the moment. All the kinds of things we think about, we could look at in some ways as problem solving. There's other kinds of thinking quite clearly, but in looking at a problem, you either have a well-defined problem or an ill-defined problem. Well-defined simply have clear conditions of the way things are and a pretty clear view of where you want to be. And that's nice when you have a clear problem, because then you can try different things out, and because you have clear definitions, you can see the effects pretty quickly and whether they're going in a positive or negative direction and adjust accordingly. But many of the problems we face in our lives, in terms of our own happiness, our satisfaction, our employment, what we're going to do with ourselves, are ill-defined, right? They don't have a very clear state of where I am or where I want to be. A lot of times I might know where I am, but not necessarily what I want to do or how I want to do it. Do I want to be in this relationship anymore? Do I want to seek that relationship? Do I want to be in this job anymore? Do I want to seek that job? And when you get up on the societal level, most problems are ill-defined. If they were well-defined, they'd be fairly easy to solve. The economy is not something you can just fix, because it's so complicated, you get 100 PhD economists in the same room arguing about what things are important to figure in and factor in, many of which can't even be measured with a lot of reliability. So somebody saying, well, I know how to fix it, is probably either being naive about the situation or they're trying to sell you something, their perspective. They want your vote so they can be in power to make their guesswork as valid as anybody's guesswork, because it's hard to know what an economy is, much less how to fix it. What would you do? There's lots of people with lots of ideas, but if it was a clearly defined problem, there'd be pretty clearly defined solutions and it would have been fixed. And even when we fix it, guess what's gonna happen? It's gonna break again because it's not well defined, it's not easy to understand, and it's certainly not easy to manipulate it with reliability and validity. But people like to believe this because they're not really problem solving, they're really engaging in emotional debates instead of intellectual discourse. Problem solving really involves two steps, interpreting and trying to solve. So interpretation is one issue, so fixation is a type of block to interpreting problems objectively. There are a lot of ways you can interpret quote-unquote facts. If you're looking at the economy, you can look at lots of indices that might indicate certain aspects of the economy. How you interpret that is not just clear-cut. It has a lot to do with your own worldview, your own background, your own expertise or lack thereof in the discipline. And that clouds or limits the way you can interpret certain things. But in general life, we have the same issue. Just try to figure out issues with ourselves and with each other, it's hard for us to think outside of the box. And that's a cliche that we'll see actually holds true. So a fixation is being fixated upon a certain interpretation such that you're not really able to consider other possible interpretation. Functional fixedness is really a type of fixation where you can't see that an object might have a function other than the typical function used. For example, you need a screwdriver, but you don't got one, so you go, I can't unscrew this screw. But if you are not functionally fixed, you can see that a screwdriver might be anything that could fit into the slot of a screw. And if you got a dime, that could be a screwdriver. If you need torque and you got a dime and a pair of pliers, now you've got a powerful screwdriver. One day it was, I was coming up these stairs, And I wear these little shoes that don't really have much sole on them that protect me from some glass, but a nail will go through them rather easily. And I noticed on this step that there was a nail head sticking out. And I didn't want to step on it myself, but I didn't want anybody else to step on it either. And I thought to myself, what can I do about that? Well, if I was at home, I'd just get my hammer, a couple taps, and it'd be gone. But there ain't no hammer in here. I don't know where I can get a hammer in here. And I could just go, oh, well, interpretation is that I need a hammer to fix the problem. Right? And there's the other idea that if all the tool you have is a hammer, then every problem is a nail. But I just thought a little bit more about it. I said, you know what? I found this. This, if placed just right, and with a little guidance on my toe, could be a pretty effective hammer. And in fact, it worked. And it's still in there, and it hadn't come out since then. So, functional fixedness. I can't get the window to stay open. Well, perhaps a book would work. You see what I'm saying? Things outside the box are not what we usually go to because we are fixated inside the box. That is to say, we are constrained. And then when we have some idea, we have blocks that are strategy blocks. Mental set. Very similar idea. You have a fixation now on only certain types of solutions. So if those solutions don't work, you might not be able to consider alternative solutions because you're going to think you've thought of all of them. You've exhausted your options, and therefore it's insolvable or intractable problem. So one way around a mental set is through insight, ways of interpreting a problem that yields a solution instantaneously, or working through it. As we'll see, there are some various approaches you can take consciously that will help you think your way out of problems that you would normally not think to think your way out of. So mental set is very similar, but now we're talking about the strategy one uses. In fixation, we're talking about interpreting problems, including the parameters, which might be where you're at now, where you'd like to go, and then strategy blocks, mental sets, how am I going to get there? What's the strategy to solve the problem? If I'm constrained in either or, which could be both, right, then I'm going to have a difficult time solving problems. And some problems are complicated and have big, big implications in our life. And some are not so complicated, but really have some interesting implications in our life. So don't talk, because you don't want to use your other friend's brain. You want to use yours on this. Here's a demonstration of fixation. Draw 9 dots and 3 equal columns and rows on your paper. It can just be little pinpoints, just enough to have a dot to go through. Then, here, once you get that down, I'll let you draw your dots. The instructions are these for solving this problem. Here it is. Connect all 9 dots with 4 straight lines without lifting your pen or pencil off the paper. You may cross the lines, but you may not retrace any portion of the line. Go to it. Connect all 9 dots with 4 straight lines without lifting your pen or pencil off the paper. You may cross the lines, but not retrace any portion of the line. Just give it your best shot. And don't work with each other, because that's actually a good technique to get around this. Give you a few seconds to think about it. Drawing pals to make a point, now we're drawing points to make a point. All right. Anybody think they got it? Raise your hand if you think you got it for sure. Have you done it before? Okay. Well, we'll see if you got it. Some people are like, oh, yeah, I know it. And I'm like, have you done it before? Like, yeah, I've done it before. So if you've done it before, at least you remembered how to do it again, right? First line, coming out there past the end, then back through past the top, then back down, and then back across. Four lines, straight, no retracing, no lifting the pen off the paper. Zoop, 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 zoop. How many people got it? Yeah, congratulations. It's a difficult thing to get. Why? Because we have a fixation, right? We've got a mental set. We have self-imposed rules. What do? We went outside the box, didn't we? Literally went outside the box. But what do you learn in kindergarten about crayons and drawing? Stay in the lines. You go, oh, they go, no, 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 that's a mess. You have to stay in the lines. You have to stay constrained. And so we constrain ourselves. That's how easy it is to demonstrate thinking outside the box. To solve the problem, you literally have to draw outside the box. Nowhere in the instructions does it prohibit that. In fact, it describes exactly what you need to do. But because we're not accustomed to going outside of the lines, we don't usually interpret that as a possible solution. As such, we don't engage in it. So everybody in here is 100% normal, and some of us are a little bit creative. I always have to see it again to remember how to do it right.